Hello world! Today I will give you a very brief intro to timers. We will see a note timer and a timer that we do ourselves by code, and we call this a custom timer. First we create a timer note which we add to our scene tree. Then we jump into our code, which you see is completely empty, and I'm going to define a variable which will be the time for how long I want my timer to run for. Let's do this a float, and we start with 5 seconds. Now we go into a ready function, we create this real quick, and in here I want my timer to be started. I can either just choose the timer with a dollar sign notation in front, or I can drag and drop the node inside of my code and it auto completes for itself. Now here with the timer we can do a few things. If we click on the timer node and we look at it in the inspector, you can see that we have especially three main components that we should care about: wait time, one shot, and auto start. The auto start is simply to start the timer whenever it is instantiated into our scene, which we will leave on turned off. We will start it manually. One shot says whether this timer is going to repeat itself endlessly, or if it just runs once and when it hits zero, it stops. For the time being, we set our wait time to be equals to what we said is going to be our timer's time. So this will be 5 seconds. Then we will say that auto start is going to be false. I mean, it is by default, but just to give the example here. And then our timer, we will say that our one shot will be true. Fabulous. We have a running and working timer, except we have to start it for it to work. Timer.start is the function that starts a timer, and timer.stop obviously will stop the timer if you ever have the need to stop it midway. Now let's do something to see of a timer in action. Let's create the process function. And once we have this, I want to get my note label, and I will update the text to be and say note timer. And we add to this, we cast to a string our timer, and here comes the next thing, dot time left. This gives us back the time that the timer still has left until it runs to zero. If we want to run anything, we have to get rid of the timer.stop function, or we'll stop it right after starting it, and we can try it out. Now you see that it runs and it has a lot of numbers here in the back. Let me give you a real quick introduction to formatting strings. We will have something that defines how our number here should be displayed in our string. Now we should have only 2 decimal numbers in the back. Let's see this working, and yeah, it looks much better. Perhaps I will do a video on formatting strings or formatting in general a little bit later in another video. Now as we see, our timer, when it hits zero, it is not restarting at all and it just stops. Now how neat it would be that if we had a function that says start timer, and every time that we time out we would say that our timer should start again. Now we can do that. There's a signal on this timer node. If we go into the node in the scene tree and then on our inspector to the node and signals that we have, the signal is called timeout. We can connect to this timeout signal either by double clicking and adding it to our script, or you can also do custom connections, and that's what we will do. We will initiate this timer. And when we initiate this timer, we say the timeout signal should be connected to our function that we just created. So start timer should be called whenever we time out. This will restart the timer every time. It is very silly because we could just say set one shot to false and would have the same result. But bear with me, it's for the example. Let's start this, and once we hit zero on this timer, we should see that it pops back to 5 seconds and starts counting down again. Wonderful, it works. Good, let's get rid of this. This is as much as you would do with a timer node. Let's do something else and let's build a custom timer here. And though it sounds fancy, it's just going to do exactly the same thing that our timer does, except we do it manually. Now, you see that in a process function we have this delta, and gives us a value that is passing in between each of these frames. The delta should always sum up to 1 second. And the more frames we do, the smaller this delta is. The slower our computer runs, the less frames we do, the bigger this number is going to be. This ensures for our timer that we will have always 1 second, no matter how fast we go through this process function, because a PC that runs by 60 frames per second calls this function 60 times every second. A PC that's slower with 30 frames per second, for example, calls this function only 30 times per second. When we add up these deltas in between of those rendered frames, we always get exactly 1 second, or really close to it. Now we can use this if we set a new variable and we say this custom time, set this to a float, and this also will be 5 seconds. Then what we will do is that as long as custom time is greater than zero, we will just subtract delta from our custom time. Minus equals delta. And else we have a case when we hit zero, I will reset my custom time. And that is, well, maybe it was a bit stupid. Let's create a constant and we say that is our time and we say that is 5 seconds. Grande, and then we can set it to be time again to 5 seconds. Very cool. If we run this, we won't see anything yet. Let's do the same with this as we did with the other label. This one is called custom. And what I want is, since we're subtracting from custom time and custom time will reduce over time, we just plug that in here and voila, I have two labels that show the same time now because they should run. Oh, it's not running. Now they run both the same and they will repeat running again and again and again and again. Now, perhaps you ask yourself, okay, we have connected a function to our timer through a signal. Now, if you have a custom timer, obviously that's not needed. What you can do is directly call a signal. For example, we can do the function. We call this one timer ended. And what we will do is simply print timer ended. Nothing complicated here. This way you could easily connect a function if we call the function whenever we run to zero. Once we hit the zero, we just print out timer ended. I hope I could spend your time valuably. Thanks for watching, keep creating awesome games, and see you in the next one.